Beirut, once the most beautiful city in the Middle East. Since 1975, it has been physically shattered and culturally divided, torn apart by civil war between Muslims and Christians and by foreign invasion forces. In the summer of 1982, scenes like this were commonplace in the streets of West Beirut. The siege and bombardment of West Beirut were meticulously documented day by day. It is the books, films, and photographs of the carnage, destruction, and suffering which influence world opinion and reshape attitudes to Lebanon, Israel, and the Palestinians. Perhaps above all, the photographs. This is the story of two very different photographers, both based in Paris. One is a Frenchman, the other a Lebanese. Fouad Elkhoury studied in Paris and London, qualified as an architect, but became increasingly interested in photography. The war in Lebanon drew Fouad back to Beirut to look for his friends and to see for himself what had happened to the city. He began taking photographs, and on the strength of his pictures, he was signed up by the French agency Sigma. Alain Mangam is one of France's leading photojournalists. He's covered wars in Afghanistan, Mozambique, Angola, Iran, and Iraq. He works out of another French agency, Gamma. Mangam is the total professional, experienced in moving between opposing armies and finding his way around press and censorship restrictions. His reputation allows him to decide for himself which assignments he'll take.
I went to the press center, and it was a telex announcing that the Israeli ambassador in London has been shot. So I say, well, this is a sort of instinct. I say, this is the beginning of something very important. And straight, I call Air France, and I book myself on a flight to one to Beirut and one to Tel Aviv. I left on Saturday. On Sunday morning, and during the night, well, at midnight, the Israeli troops went in.
Why was it so important to you to be in Beirut?
I was Lebanese, and being Lebanese, it is very difficult to just look at what's happening from the outside. It's difficult to explain it, but the way I can try and show it to you is by an analogy to, for instance, if, I hope not, but one of the members of your family die somewhere outside where you are. The first instinctive move that you will do is to go wherever they are because you know that they are dying. You want to be nearer to them as near as possible to them as you can in order that you can grab whatever life comes out of them, at least the last minute.
You were travelling with the Israeli army right up through South Lebanon. How difficult is it to get your pictures out of Lebanon and back to Europe?
The thing was that every day we have to come back by road, of course, to Jerusalem, to go through the censorship, first to the lab, then to the censorship, and then to the airport to ship all the film by freight, and then to be next morning back, you know, around 3-4 o'clock in the morning to go through the border and to join again the Israeli troops were still advance. And this was really, it was really hard, really, really hard.
You were there in Beirut for the whole of the siege. What was it really like?
All the people that stayed made one big family. And so morally, it was very comfortable to be in Beirut, no matter what people say. And no matter how many dead people there were, it was very comfortable because you felt you belonged somewhere in the world and you knew you were right in a sense because you weren't the aggressor, you were aggressed. So bearing in mind this moral situation, the day-to-day life was punctuated by the bombing and shelters and grabbing food and grabbing water.
In taking your pictures with the Israeli invasion forces, as they moved through Lebanon, what really were you looking for? I mean, what were you trying to show in your photographs?
Well, I should say that for me, the only thing was to show what is a war. Because I don't care, in one way, whether they were Israeli on one side or Palestinian on the other side. The thing is, there is a war, and because of this war, our population is going to be with a lot of problems, with people killed, with people starving, with kids in a very, very, well, dramatic situation. And maybe because of this picture, you could help them to try to survive this dramatic period they are living. This is the reason why, if you try to go with an army and to try to show that, well, if you listen to the military communique, it seems that a war is always clean, right? This is most of the time, the communique.
Press releases.
And in fact, it is not. This is the reason why the journalists are there and they try to work. But if for a journalist who is writing, it's very difficult to sometimes to explain that. If you get a picture with a, well, let's say a strong picture, there's no doubt about that.
It makes no difference to you whether it's an Israeli who's suffering or a Palestinian who's suffering.
No, seriously.
The job would still be the same.
The job would still be the same.
Are all your pictures subjective?
Yes, very much so. I think everybody from my photos can tell which side I'm on.
Should we see your photographs really as propaganda photographs?
No. The fact that you emotionally feel towards one side does not mean that you are doing propaganda. At least I don't see it this way. Now people can say this. The love I put in my photos to try and explain that this particular side of the conflict or this particular people are also human beings and are also have human feelings and crying and swimming and smiling and all this is only to show to the people that because Palestinians were known of as terrorists, they are not only this. And so, okay, it might be propaganda, but it's also a human side in which I put all my love and my emotions.
The editor and everybody working on the picture or on the features, they were very, very severe concerning the caption. We put only the facts. We will try to attack maybe a paper who doesn't respect, you know, this caption, because it's a question of credibility for the agency, for the photographer, because don't forget something, that tomorrow we will be the one who will get back there.
And we will go back to the
place,
the situation.
And we could have problem.
Talking was important because I wanted to make myself be admitted as a Lebanese, not as a foreign photographer who was coming just to take photos and go. And so talking was a way of solving this problem because the language was common. I wouldn't be afraid of taking a photo of this particular person I would want to photograph, and I would try and reduce the distance between her and me because of this preliminary contact that I had established. And instinctively, because I felt better and in my element, I would go much nearer to the people and make the camera obvious between the two of us. And so if she wanted to express something because she knew she had a camera in front of her, she could. It wasn't, I will try and steal a photo. It was, on the contrary, we both know that there is a camera between us. How do we react?
I should really consider, for me, that this picture expressed more than, maybe a soldier, you know, fighting with his Kalashnikov. I would like to, when I'm looking to this picture, ask myself, tomorrow, I mean, when this guy, in a few years, what will be his future? Will be also a new fighter for tomorrow? Maybe, for sure. But that means that tomorrow, I mean, well, we'll have to come back. And we never enjoy to go on a war. This is something very important. If you begin to enjoy war, I mean, as a photographer, well, let's say maybe it's time to change the job.
If there were photographers to do all the other photos that the medias in Europe demanded, such as the Palestinians on their tanks and sending missiles or whatever, or all the frontline work. I thought, well, if this is a kind of impression that people will want, surely one day the rest will be as interesting. So I had never any problems of that sort. In fact, I never felt as good as last year during the siege as a photographer. And this particular photo isn't very interesting, but it's interesting knowing its context. And the context is simply that the day before, literally the day before, there was 14 hours of bombing. It was the last big bombing of Beirut. And the following day, even though we didn't know what was the result of all the political negotiations that were going on between the heads of the war, this guy automatically went and installed his shop. The radio was the only thing that was left in Beirut. There was no electricity, no TV, no telephone. So all the news you would get, apart from the friends that would tell you whatever was happening on the front, was the radio and all the radios of the world.
What are they looking at and what is actually happening around them?
Well, in front of them, there's about five bodies wrapped in cellophane. Behind, there's about 30 waiting to be unloaded and people to come and recognize the mutilated faces. And a bit far away, there is the building that the Israelis bombed, trying to shoot at Arafat, who was actually meeting in this building and who had escaped. But meanwhile, there were 200 people dead, so there was somewhere 200 bodies that people had to identify, and there were destruction and crumbling and all that sort, and dust and people with masks and smell of putrefaction. And I didn't want to take all these photos, all these ones. I just wanted to concentrate on the faces. As a journalist, accompanying Yasser Arafat was an incredible thing because I was conscious of the historical moment that this was, that Arafat, the big leader of the Palestinians, was actually leaving on exile, not to go back and come back to Beirut ever again. And for the 3 days that I spent on the boat with Arafat, I was all the time conscious of this historical moment as the only photographer being able to record this particular event. Yes, there I reacted much more as a journalist than as a Lebanese, that's for sure.
As soon as my assignment was finished on Friday night, I decided to come back to my first idea, was to go to Sabra and Shatila.
To do your documentary series on life in the camps after the fighters had left.
Of course. And we left the hotel very early in the morning and we arrived around quarter past six in Sabra and Shatila. And at the beginning, we arrived on the side of the Kuwaiti embassy. We were close to an Israeli post with tanks, and it was completely quiet, completely quiet. We walked a bit in the camp. I remember we met with a woman, a very old woman. We didn't speak. Was completely she was really we say in French agar. She walked
Like a zombie.
See, it's not normal, because in Beirut everybody used to wake up very early in the morning, kids, they play and so, nothing. So we took the first street in the camp on the left side, and then we discover this house with the white horse. I'm looking for this picture with the white horse, and we realize that something wrong was happening there. Well, the first reaction was a shock, because I should say you could get used to death because of our job, but it was so dramatic, and you know, just to see the babies kill the woman, I mean, the first reaction is to say, well, I have to be very careful, because you're trying to control yourself. And I should say that you have to use a very fast speed. You know, not to work on the 125 speed. You see what I mean?
You must use a fast shutter speed. Why is that?
Because, you know, anyway, you are shocked a bit. You know, it's impossible, I mean, to look such a massacre without a sort of emotive reaction. So, I mean, you have to be, to control yourself. And then, well, you go, you walk. And it was terrible, because you walk and you didn't keep up. Discovering bodies and bodies. I got about 1, 2, 3, 4, about 8 pictures of the white horse, because this was symbolic. You decide that it's important to get the white horse. Why? Because it really showed that it was a massacre. I mean, they kill everything. I mean, in life, in the camp. I shipped my film, I went back to the hotel. I came straight back to the camp, because I knew that it was not enough. We were walking in a small street in Sabra and Shatila, and suddenly appears a mother with grandmother and a daughter. She walked, she opened the house, and she discovered bodies. And she turned back against us, and we were the one responsible for that. We were the one. She speak Arabic, but she really was very, 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 very nervous. And she tried, she came to us, you know, and she say, I didn't understand, but I really feel that she was really, really, I would say that in English.
She was blaming you.
Blaming, I mean, she was really, you know, and this, you were asking me how some time to decide to make pictures. She was so close to me, to my friend and myself. That, I mean, you know, just the fact to do that and take your camera, do that, will make the people understand the stress of this mother. And you have to do it. You have, to, you know, to do that. And it's hard, believe me, it's hard to do that in front of this woman, you know.
American embassy blows into pieces due to a bomb. I have to rush, because This is my work. I have to rush and photograph. There's a small street leading to the American embassy, because no cars was allowed. So I go with my cameras, which I always carry when I'm working. I rush into this small street, and there I realize that a friend of mine is completely wounded because she lives nearby. She has received all glass projectiles in her head. So what do you do? Either you help her and you put her in an ambulance, or you carry on working. I'm a Lebanese as well, so I helped her. By that time, there was about 30 minutes that I had lost. When I arrived there, there wasn't much that the media could have wanted. I come back home, where the telephone from Sigma arrives. The conversation was going like, do you have any corpses? No, I don't have. Do you have not even limbs? I said, no, I haven't gotten limbs. Don't you have any carbonized heads lying on the pavements like we see coming from UPI radio photos? No, unfortunately, I don't. Don't you have any flames? No, I don't. And you have nothing in color like hands or heads or anything like this? And I say no, thinking even Buñuel wouldn't have done such a conversation in most of his surrealist films. And then when I put the phone down, I say, this is impossible. I can't continue like this. Half an hour later, I learned that a friend of mine was actually killed in the thing. And I was completely upset. I didn't know what to do, and I had to go back and photograph the embassy at night. And it was very unbearable as a kind of work.
Don't you go as an outsider, and one might say as a voyeur?
Well, all of us are photographers, cameramen, journalists. I mean, we are voyeur, for sure. Sure, excuse me. But the thing is, there is a big difference between to be a voyeur, which seems to be absolutely necessary to do his job, as so far you don't violate the people. And to be what we call in French, maybe it's the same in English, a charognard. That means that somebody who is looking for death, for the drama of the others, because it will help to maybe to make some money, maybe to be considered himself as a hero. Well, this is the bad side of the profession. When you come back to Paris or to London or to New York or other place, I think that, you have a sort of a sense of relativeness. I mean that you get a particular scale of value. You see what I mean? It's impossible to come back in Paris, for instance, and to discover home. That the main problem is the washing machine, which gets a breakdown. And it's nothing. It could be very important for your domestic life, but you already don't care. Normally, I don't speak during 3 or 4 days.
Alain Mangam is now in Paris planning his next assignment. Fouad Elkhoury has left the Sigma agency, but intends to continue working as a photojournalist.